Good morning. Welcome here this morning. We're happy to see those that are here in the building. We also welcome those of you who are watching from home. So I just invite you to stand and let's sing and praise God together.
We worship you this morning. You are the reason that we have gathered together today to sing praises to you, to bless your name, to make much of you in this place. And so, God, we just invite your presence here and online in our homes to just come and meet with us, encourage us and challenge our hearts and convict us if need be through the power of your word as we study and learn and grow in our walk with you, Jesus. So, we just pray all of this in your name. Amen. Amen. Why don't you take a seat for just a moment? I want to welcome you here this morning and online as well. Couple of announcements just to make you aware of things going on, and then we want to watch a testimony video together. Our AGM is coming up. Our annual business meeting is going to be on September 14th at 6:30. We had thought that we could have 50 people gathering up here and 50 downstairs, but the province, that was the rule, but now, of course, there's a new rule. So we can have 50 people in total in the building at one given time. So for our AGM, we're just encouraging maybe one person per household to come. And we're going to live stream the AGM as well with the password. And so if you're interested in at least watching and keeping up to date, we can send you that link as well. And we're still working out details of how members can vote by proxy and not be here anyways. So the registration for the AGM is on our website and on Facebook. And so if you want to come to that, just one per household. And as soon as we're at 50, that's all we can have. We're actually coming up September 25th. That's a Friday night at 6 p.m. We're having a movie night here at the church. I was going to say some random movie, but no, we're watching a movie called The American Gospel. And so registration for that, again, we'll have 50 people. It's going to open up on Friday. It's free to come. You just have to make sure that you get a ticket. I won't go into all the details, but you can watch the movie trailer on YouTube. But American Gospel is a great movie, basically laying out, okay, what is the biblical gospel, and how has, you know, the North American church twisted it or changed it to make it more palatable, or and why that's not a good thing. So it's a fantastic movie, and so we'll watch that and then have an hour of discussion afterwards. So that's coming up Friday, September 25th at 6 p.m. Lastly, before we just continue in worship, there are going to be a whole bunch of stuff starting in the fall. Senior youth is going to start, junior youth, young adults, breakout, lots of stuff coming up, and we're going to give you details of dates and starting things for that as well coming up. You can't do this at home, but if everyone would turn and look at our rinky-dink camera setup here, so it's a platform on top of a pew, and then another platform on top of that, and then, so we are just throwing this out there. It's not in our budget, but we would like to build a safer, more permanent camera station there, because the way it looks, we're going to be meeting in smaller groups and doing a lot of online stuff, probably for at least the next year. And so if you are someone who likes to give financially to a project, or you're going, yep, I can help with that, please talk to me or Christy. It will be non-receiptable. It'll just go straight to building a more permanent, safer camera station. So if you want to be involved with that, please come talk to me afterwards. Or you can message us online if you want to give to that. So we're going to watch Donetta Braun's testimony, and she is going to be a member of the church. So go ahead and watch this.
I'm Donetta Braun, and I grew up in Fort St. John in a Christian home, and went to Calvary Baptist Church, and yeah, I grew up going to Sunday school and church, and yeah, I became a Christian when I was 7 years old, mostly because I wanted to drink the juice in church, and because my cousins got to do it, so it was kind of like, well, I want to do that too. Yeah, but then my faith grew over time. Yeah, just through Sunday school and youth group, and yeah. Yeah, when I went to YC, in youth group, I recommitted my life. And then when I was a teenager, I kind of recommitted my life a couple times because I wanted to make sure that it was like, is this real? But yeah, so it wasn't like a aha moment, I don't think, but it was just working in me my whole life, God working in my life. A big thing, like just becoming a mom is a huge, God's been there. My son has severe allergies, and I never knew really what anxiety was until I discovered he had allergies, and that's a big struggle in my life. Yeah, I really had to depend on God just to take care of him and know what steps to take, and yeah, because I can find myself get really, really anxious about things, and I just have to surrender it to God, and then he gives me a peace about it. And gives me answers sometimes, like, should I be giving him medicine, or things like that. So, I think, well, even just this COVID thing, right? Like, I've had anxiety through it, too, I think I know for sure. And, yeah, it's just depending on God, and learning to depend on him and trust in him through things, and and making your decisions about whether you should send your kid to school or not and all those things. So yeah, it's a big, yeah, I find that just depending on him. He's always reminding me to like depend on him and yeah, cast your all anxieties and your stress and everything on him. Like it's not hard to do or not easy to do, but yeah, that's a big thing. I really, God put it on my heart, and I felt like he was actually saying to me, like, you need to do this, you need to become a member, you need to own up to the church you're going to, and I kind of, so I just thought I wanted to obey God, because I really felt like he was telling me to do it, so, you know, I wanted to just follow him.
Awesome. I'm going to ask Donetta to actually come up. We want to welcome her into membership this morning, and so maybe while she's coming, worship team, you can come up and get plugged in and ready to lead us in worship as well. We just want to pray for Donetta, and then you can, I guess you just saw a face, but you can see a real in-person face, and just welcome you into membership. And so would you just pray with me and join me? So God, I thank you for Donetta's testimony. I thank you for how you guided her and led her all of these years, even through difficult times like becoming a mom and figuring out what that looks like, even during this season that we've all been living in with anxiety and stress. Just thank you for your faithfulness to her. Thank you, God, that you put it on her heart to become a member and to join the family here. And so, God, would you just use her gifts that you've given her, help her to grow in her faith and to be a blessing to others in this church as well. And so, God, we just pray all of this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Awesome. Why don't we, like, say welcome at home, clap too. You can go down. I'll ask you to stand. We want to enter into a time of singing together. You can go ahead and stand. Psalm 103 says this, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. As for man, his days are like grass. He flourishes like a flower of the field. For the wind passes over it and it's gone, and its place knows it no more. But the steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear him, and his righteousness to children's children, to those who keep his covenant and remember to do his commandments. The Lord has established his throne in the heavens, and his kingdom rules over all." Let's sing together.
To the dark. My life is
would you pray with me? So Jesus, we just worship you. You are worthy of all of our praise and worship. We just bless your name. We just sing and remember all the things that you've done for us. And so just thank you for this time that we've had where we can come and lift our eyes off of ourselves and remember, Jesus, your life and your death and your resurrection. How you've redeemed us and saved us, freed us from our slavery to sin and death. And so now, Jesus, as we turn to your word, I just pray, Holy Spirit, that you would teach us here in this building, at home watching. Just God, give us ears to hear the challenge from your word. Just encourage us and equip us and convict us if need be. And so we just pray all of this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. You can go ahead and take a seat. As you're doing so, why don't you, at home and here, grab a Bible and you can turn to Micah chapter 6. For those of you at home, you won't be able to tell, but I hope you're enjoying the luxury pews now, more leg room, right? We upgraded you all for free. But turn in your Bibles, Micah 6. So we are quickly approaching the end of the book of Micah. We have two more chapters left, and then we will be done with this great book of the Bible. Last week, it felt like we had a lot to get through. I feel like I used my week's worth of words on Sunday. We just had a lot. We looked at chapters 4 and 5, which were just an amazing picture of this future kingdom of God and a description of the future king of that kingdom, the Messiah, Jesus. And so what Micah did is he compared the Israelites' current situation, what they were living in, with what God's glorious kingdom was going to look like one day. And so I think it was a good discussion last week on just, you know, what is the kingdom of God? And then for you and I now, how do we live in that tension of, you know, we're already doing life in his kingdom now, but Jesus' kingdom is not fully yet here. So this morning, like I said, we want to look at Micah chapter 6. Most scholars think that Micah 6 could possibly be written or prophesied or preached near the very end of Micah's ministry. And so if you remember, Micah, you know, had a 30-year-ish ministry, and he would have seen a lot of things. He would have seen or witnessed the fall of the northern kingdom in 722 BC. He would have witnessed in 701 Assyria almost take over Jerusalem, but the people repented and God spared them. And I can almost imagine that Micah was probably thinking, hey, I'm doing a pretty good job, right? Judah, Jerusalem, they repented, they turned back to God, God spared us, but we know that it didn't last. Very shortly after, they were right back into their sin and idolatry and oppression. And so Micah would have seen those disappointing changes take place and more sin and more idolatry. And so chapter 6, it feels like one last attempt at a wake-up call for the Israelites. Chapter 6 is quite a fascinating chapter of the Bible. It's written as a courtroom scene. Israel is accused, and God calls in witnesses, and he interrogates his people, and he provides his people an opportunity to respond, and then finally he delivers the verdict of that courtroom scene. So it's quite interesting how this chapter is set up. So if your Bibles are open, I'll begin reading in Micah 6, starting in verse 1. Hear what the Lord says. Arise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the indictment of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth, for the Lord has an indictment against his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of slavery, and I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. Oh, my people, remember what Balak, king of Moab, devised and what Balaam, the son of Beor, answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the righteous acts of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? The voice of the Lord cries to the city, and it is sound wisdom to fear your name. Hear of the rod and of him who appointed it. Can I forget any longer the treasures of wickedness in the house of the wicked and the scant measure that is accursed? Shall I acquit the man with wicked scales and with a bag of deceitful weights? Your rich men are full of violence. Your inhabitants speak lies, and their tongue is deceitful in their mouth. Therefore, I strike you with a grievous blow, making you desolate because of your sins. You shall eat, but not be satisfied, and there shall be hunger within you. You shall put away, but not preserve, and what you preserve I will give to the sword. You shall sow, but not reap. You shall tread olives, but not anoint yourselves with oil. You shall tread grapes, but not drink wine, for you have kept the statutes of Omri and all the works of the house of Ahab, and you have walked in their counsels, that I may make you a desolation and your inhabitants a hissing, so you shall bear the scorn of my people. The reading of God's word. So, like I said, it's quite an interesting chapter, how it progresses and how Micah almost builds his case against the people. And the way that Micah is speaking is he's speaking first person. This is God himself speaking to the people. And so God is inviting his people to plead their case. And it's almost as if, you know, he's calling them to the courtroom and he's bringing in his witnesses. He says, "Arise and plead your case before the mountains. Let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the indictment of the Lord." And so he's saying to the people, come in and plead your case. And we've seen it many times that oftentimes the prophets would speak in such a way that maybe the Israelites would think that they're talking about other nations, right? And so far, you know, arise, plead your case, let the hills hear your voice, the Lord has an indictment. And then people would be going, well, yeah, the Lord has an indictment against Babylon, against Assyria. Let's see it. Let's bring Babylon and Assyria to the courtroom. But then God says the Lord has an indictment against his people, right? And so right away the people would have said, wait, what? We're the ones on trial here? But we're God's chosen people. We're the Israelites. Why are we on trial? And the imagery is really quite amazing. The mountains themselves are called as witnesses. Like, I would love for someone to paint a picture of this. God says, let me bring in my first witness. It's the mountains. Like, that's pretty unbelievable. And here's why the imagery is really amazing. Obviously, he's using, you know, a metaphor. But the idea is, well, the mountains have witnessed generations of men's misdeeds as they, like, mountains are fixed. They don't move. They just sit there. And so what Micah is saying is the mountains have watched for generations Israel go from bad to worse to worse to worse to worse. Now, apparently some in Micah's day thought that everything was fine, right? And we've seen this several times in these first six chapters. You know, even in chapter 3 about the leadership, it says that they leaned on the Lord and they said, God's in the midst of us. So there was this thinking among some people in Israel. They said, well, no, God's happy with us. It's fine what we're doing. We're God's chosen people. And so clearly they haven't been listening to the prophets. And so God, what he's doing is he's emphasizing the seriousness of the situation and he's kind of proving his case against them. So in verse 3, God asked them two questions. Oh, my people, what have I done to you? And how have I wearied you? Answer me. Now, this is quite amazing. God is satirically claiming to search his own heart and actions. Right? It's written as satire. God is going, okay, tell me, what have I done? Right? If you think, right, essentially he's asking the people, is it my fault, right, that you're living like this? Is there something that I've done? How, why, is it my fault that you have cooled in your affections towards me? Like, how have I wearied you, Israel? So God is asking, like, how, why, is it my fault that you no longer obey me? Is it something that I've done? And this was true. The Israelites were weary of him. They were weary of his name because they worshipped Baal and Ashtoreth and Molech and all of these other false gods. So they were weary of God's name. They were weary of worshiping him, weary of obeying him, and weary of so-called, you know, restraints on their lives. Just let us live how we want, God. And so God, it's brilliant. God brings him into the courtroom, so to speak, and he says, okay, well, show me. How have I wearied you? What have I done wrong? Now, these questions assume that some in Israel believed that God had wronged them, right? Some had this view that they had done nothing wrong, and now God is saying that he's going to punish us. So it's almost as if the people viewed, like, this is God's issue. It's not our issue. And so it's almost as if God is in the wrong here. And so he asks these rhetorical questions, essentially saying to the people, okay, well, prove it to me. How have I wronged you? What have I done? Show me what I have done to make you do this. And the questions are posed with the obvious answer being, well, God has done nothing wrong. God has not wearied them. God can do nothing wrong. The issue is not with God. Now, in verses 4 and 5, then, God is going to remind the Israelites of how faithful he's been to them throughout all of these generations. He says, "For I brought you up from the land of Egypt, and I redeemed you from the house of slavery." So again, like, picture the scene. God says to the people, okay, you think that I've wronged you. How have I wronged you? Show me what I've done. And then he says, let me remind you of how faithful I've been to you. Let's go back all the way to the Exodus. You were slaves in Egypt, and God redeemed them. He directed all of the events surrounding their freedom from Egypt. And we don't have time this morning, but like, think through the 10 miraculous plagues and the Passover, and he spared their firstborn children, and then he brings them to the Red Sea, and the Red Sea parts, and they walk through on dry land. Like, miracle after miracle after miracle, God says, I freed you from slavery. God points all the way back to the Exodus and the Passover, which in the Old Testament, the Exodus was an event invested with as much significance that the cross and the resurrection bears in the New Testament, right? You know, so as followers of Jesus, every week we kind of end up at the cross, at the resurrection, what God has done for us through Jesus. The Exodus bore that same type of weight for the Old Testament people. They would look back at the Exodus and they would go, remember how God saved us, how miraculous that was. He then goes on and he says, I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. God gave good leaders to his people, right? He didn't free them from Egypt and cross the Red Sea and then go, well, good luck, right? Have fun out there. No, he gave them Moses, who represents the law and leadership. He gave them Aaron, representing the priesthood and the sacrificial system. He gave them Miriam, who was a songstress and a prophetess. So God not only saved them from slavery, but then he gave them good leaders as they journeyed. He continues in verse 5. He says, oh, my people, remember what Balak, king of Moab, devised and what Balaam, the son of Beor, answered him. So if you remember that story from Numbers chapters 22 to 24, it's an amazing story. I would encourage you to read it. But basically, the king of Moab saw all this nation of Israel, and he wanted to curse them. And so he hired Balaam. He said, come, and I want you to pronounce curses on these these people. And so if you remember, right, Balaam, and then his donkey speaks to him. It's a crazy story. But God basically says to Balaam, no, you're not going to curse my people. I want you to go and you're going to bless them. And so for three times in a row, Balaam stands over, right, they're on the mountain, and they look at all the nation of Israel, and he pronounces blessing on them. And the Israelites were in the midst of sin and rebellion, and God blesses them. So God's reminding the people in Micah's day, remember how I did that. And what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that's where Israel crossed the Jordan into the promised land. God says, remember how I did that for you. And then verse 5 ends with why God is asking them to remember all these things, that you may know the righteous acts of the Lord. He says, remember what I've done. And you'll notice if you read not just the Old Testament, but the entire Bible constantly is telling us, remember what God has done. Remember what God has done. Don't forget. Tell your children. Tell your grandchildren. Don't forget what God has done for you. And so God is saying, remember. Because the faith of God's people is strengthened in the present by recounting what he's done in the past. God says, think back to all of the ways that I've been faithful to you. Now, verses 6 and 7 is written almost as the people's response back to God. Micah writes in such a way as to speak what the people would have been thinking. And so it says, with what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? So the way that this is written is suggesting that the people are actually responding to God's accusations. God is saying, you people in Israel, you're sick and tired of me. And God is asking, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? And he's proven that God has actually done nothing but be faithful and gracious to them. And now they're responding essentially by saying, well, no, God, we're not sick of you. What are you talking about? And verses 6 and 7 are the people responding to God going, what do you want, God? And then they recite a list of religious activities that might get them out from under God's demands, right? So they say, well, should we come with burnt offerings? Do you want a calf a year old? And that was kind of considered the cream of the crop. Do you want 1,000 rams? Do you want 10,000 rivers of oil? Do you want my firstborn son? See, the question turns from quality to then quantity, and it just kind of ramps up. Do you want the best year-old calf? Do you want 10,000 rams? Or do you want 1,000 rams? Do you want 10,000 rivers of oil? Do you want me to, like, kill my own kid? Is that what you want, God? I mean, hypothetical, obviously, but it's just leading up to just, it's actually ludicrous what they're responding to God with. The value of their sacrifice escalates in an attempt to discern, okay, what is the price for entering God's presence? And really, these proposals just increase in absurdity, ending with this outrageous statement. So what Micah is doing is he's actually exposing an attitude that wrongly sees sacrifice as an entry fee rather than an avenue for God to administer grace and forgiveness. So, I mean, if I could put it, and I have a little bit, but if I could put it in our day and age, basically the people are asking, what do you want, God? Right, you're accusing us that we've grown weary of you, and we don't think we have. God, what do you want? Do you want more sacrifices? Is that going to make you happy? Like, are we not doing enough for you? Basically, they're saying, God, what do we have to do to get you off of our case? See, it sounds like a teenager almost. Like, what do you want, mom and dad? Blah. That's how they're responding. They're saying, God, what do you want? We're obviously blind. We don't see what the issue is. So do you just want more sacrifices from us? See, it was a fundamental wrong view of what God actually wanted from his people. God, aren't we doing what you ask? Because the people would say, like, we offer sacrifices to you. We jump through hoops. We do what you want. We check the boxes. So why are you coming down so hard on us? And verse 8, God responds to them. He says, he has told you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice, and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. God is far more interested in the person than any gift that someone might bring. What God is saying is that character and behavior actually matter to him. And I love that he says, he's told you, O man, what is good. It's not as if God is saying in Micah, well, let me tell you for the first time what I actually expect from you. He says, no. I've already told you this. Like, I've told you what is good. You should know this. God actually wanted a relationship with his people. And listen, that has always been obtained on the basis of faith. The law, with its sacrificial system, has never been about works. It's about faith. Faith in God. Trust in who he said he was. Trust that his ways are good. People were not saved in the Old Testament by how good they kept the law. They obeyed the law in faith, going, yes, we believe that God is who he says he is, and that these rules and laws are for our benefit, and so we're going to have faith in God. See, I think sometimes we have this skewed view. We see God in the Old Testament. God's only accessible by rules. He's only interested in you obeying perfectly and killing animals. He actually doesn't care about you. It's just obey. And then finally the New Testament comes, and oh, Jesus comes, and Jesus is about mercy and love and grace, and God kind of cools off a little bit. But all along, from the very beginning, God desired people's hearts for them to love him and long to obey him. And so we see that in verse 8, because I want you to notice, God gives them three things that he requires of them. Notice that he doesn't say, here's a bunch of commandments that I want you to do. Notice that he doesn't say, yeah, offer more sacrifices, but he gives them three things. First of all, he says, I want you to do justice. And justice essentially means the prohibition of oppression or bribery or dishonesty. It includes protection from foreigners or protection of foreigners and the poor and slaves and widows and orphans, those who could very easily be taken advantage of. And so what God is essentially calling them to is integrity and honesty in how they interacted with other people, especially the vulnerable. Like, do you actually care about justice? Do you take care of those who can't take care of themselves? Now, the sad part is, and we've seen it, the Israelites loved injustice because it made them rich. God calls them, I want you to do justice, and the Israelites actually excelled in doing injustice. Secondly, God calls them to love kindness. And depending on your translation, some Bibles say love mercy, some say steadfast love. And the reason is the word kindness in Hebrew is chesed, which is a really fascinating word because it's one of those words in Hebrew that means a bunch of things, and we just don't have a really good English word that encapsulates all of it. The word chesed means loyalty, it means mercy. It's a term of relationship, and it expresses this attitude of covenant between God and people or people. It's the way to say it actually best, when God says, I want you to love kindness, he basically says, I want you to have a loyal love that contains mercy. So there's no real English word that captures that, and that's often used of God towards us. His loving kindness towards us, his steadfast love and mercy shown to us. God wants his people to extend that same chesed, that same loyal, steadfast love and mercy to other people. And lastly, God calls them to walk humbly. And the word humbly is tasana, which is another interesting word. It's actually only used here in the entire Old Testament. And it's best defined as lowly or carefully is another way to describe it. To walk carefully with God. To walk lowly with God. Walking lowly with God is essentially the opposite of self-centeredness and turning your own way. Walking lowly is the best description of authentic humility. Someone who walks in pride thinks that life is about them and other people around them are simply there to make their life better. I mean, we all know people like that, who the world kind of revolves around them, and if you're friends with them, oftentimes you feel like, well, I'm only here because you want your life to be better. That's how people walk with pride. Someone who walks in humility or walks lowly is someone who says, I believe God, and therefore I obey God. It's not about me. Now, like I said, I find it really interesting that what God requires of his people is all about their character and their motivation. Like I said, notice that God doesn't say, yeah, here's a bunch of commandments that you haven't been doing. Do those. Notice that God doesn't say, yeah, you're right. You got to offer more sacrifices. Here's why. Someone who lives and does these things, does justice, loves kindness, and walks humbly with God, will obey God. Someone who loves justice and loves kindness and walks humbly with God, God won't have to come to them and go, hey, you're not following the rules. Because they will inherently want to obey God. Now, the problem was, like I said, the people of Israel were essentially doing the opposite of all of this. They were doing injustice, they did not love kindness, and they walked with pride. And so in verses 9 to 12, God calls them again on their injustice and wickedness, and he names specific crimes. Verse 10, the treasures of wickedness, meaning how they amassed wealth by cheating people. Verse 10, he says they use scant measures. That's how businessmen would cheat their customers. Verse 11, he talks about wicked scales and deceitful weights, referring to how they would give customers less merchandise than what they thought they were buying because their scales were rigged. So someone comes, you know, I'm going to buy a pound of grain or whatever, and so the weights, yeah, here's a pound, but it was actually half a pound. And so they would cheat people out of what they were buying. Verse 12 says, your rich men are full of violence, your inhabitants speak lies, your tongue is full of deceit. So that's what was going on in Judah. The opposite, essentially, of what God expected from his people. And then in verses 13 and 16, God hands down the verdict. Because of all of that, verse 13, he says, I'm going to strike you with a grievous blow. I'm going to make you desolate. Verse 14, you're going to eat, but you won't be satisfied. You're going to be hungry. You're going to be unable to preserve. Verse 15, you're going to sow, but you won't reap. You'll tread olives, but you're not going to enjoy the oil. You're going to tread grapes, but you're not going to enjoy the wine. So sin, we're noticing, brings destruction, sickness, desolation, hunger, dissatisfaction, and frustration. And then in verse 16, Micah mentions two men, Omri and Ahab, which were two of the most wicked kings in the northern kingdom. And so what he's saying is essentially, you are following in their footsteps, Judah. You're continuing in their sinful traditions. And chapter 6 ends by God saying, I'm going to make you a desolation, your inhabitants a hissing, so that you shall bear the scorn of my people. So I think Micah 6 gives us some really good things to wrestle with. Because it's interesting how the people of Israel respond to God. Obviously, if this passage is near the end of Micah's ministry, then things in Judah are getting worse and worse and worse. And so God comes to them and he asks, okay, well, what have I done to you for you to behave like this? How have I wearied you? So obviously there were people in Israel, in Judah, who were complaining about God. It's not fair that God is threatening to punish us. It's not fair. Maybe they were complaining about the weariness of serving him, complaining about maybe how bad things were getting. And then they respond in verses 6 and 7, essentially saying to God, what do you want, God? Like, what do we have to do? What's it going to take to get you off of our back? Now, if we're honest, I think when you and I go through hardship or suffering or pain, when you and I maybe are confronted with our sin, or even if we're confronted with the natural consequences of decisions that we've made in life, when you and I feel maybe weary of obeying Jesus or serving him or loving him, I think we can respond the exact same way. We just blame God. God, why are you doing this to me? Right? God, this is your fault. God, if you really loved me, you wouldn't have allowed this to happen. Where is God? Why is this happening? Like, who does this? And I think very quickly, we put God on trial. And you know what? It was interesting. I used to read the Old Testament, and I would read all of these miraculous things that God had done for Israel, and then how Israel very quickly just turned and rebelled and sinned. And I would often read it going, what is wrong with them? Like, if I saw all these miracles, if I saw the Red Sea part, if I saw food from heaven to feed me for in the wilderness, there's no way I would act like that. But I am exactly the same way, right? When I go through seasons where I'm disappointed, or seasons of consequences of sin, or seasons of sadness or sickness or pain, I very quickly behave exactly like this. Why, God? You're so mean. Why are you doing this? So listen, you need to hear this. The problem is never with God. God is holy and God is perfect in everything he does. Everything God does is good and righteous and holy and perfect. The problem is never with him. Psalm 18:30 says, this God, his way is perfect. The word of the Lord proves true. He's a shield for those who take refuge in him. So when we go through seasons, we need to be reminded, right? When I go, God, why are you doing this? It's not fair. The problem's not with God. And when we go through seasons like that, I think we need to do exactly what God tells his people to do. Remind yourself of how faithful God has been. Remember God's faithfulness. What has God done for you? That's what he does in Micah 6. Remember the Exodus. Remember how I saved you from Egypt. Remember how I gave you Moses and Aaron and Miriam. Remember how I used Balaam to bless you. Remember how I led you into the promised land. And the New Testament, it actually gives us similar commands over and over and over again. Remember what God has done. In Ephesians 2, Paul, he writes about what the gospel is. And then he says, therefore, remember that at one time you Gentiles, that's unbelievers, in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands, remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers to the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in the world, but now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. Remember that. Revelation 3 to the churches, remember then what you received and heard. Keep it and repent. 1 Corinthians 11, when he had given thanks, that's Jesus, he broke it and said, this is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. That's why we do communion, because Jesus says, remember what I've done for you. So I want to encourage you, when you go through seasons of hardship and pain and suffering and disappointment, and when you begin to blame God or doubt his goodness, remember what he's done. Now, I don't know the answer for why you will go through pain and suffering and hardship, but I know what the answer can't be. The answer can't be because God doesn't love you. Because look at, right, remember what he's done for you, his very son crucified for you. So when you go through pain and you go, God, why are you doing this? Well, I know what the answer isn't. It isn't because he hates you. It isn't because he doesn't love you, because we know by what he's done for us. So remember his faithfulness. Look at the cross. Look at the sacrifice Jesus made. So one of the ways that we can take encouragement from Micah 6 is to daily remind ourselves what God has done for us. Now, the other way that Micah challenges us is verse 8 is a call to us as well. The people have asked God in Micah's day, what do you want from us, God? Do you want better sacrifices? Do you want more of them? Do you want us to kill our own children? Do you want us to, like, what do you want from us, God? And God says, I want you to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly. See, God was after their hearts and their motivations. And even Jesus challenged the religious leaders in the exact same way. So almost 700 years after Micah's day, the people of God were doing the exact same thing. Let's follow the rules. Let's go through the motions. Let's check the boxes. And that will prove that we love God. That's what the Pharisees did. The Pharisees would go, look at my track record. right? Look at how many sacrifices I make for God. Look at how hungry I am when I fast. Look at how much money I give to the poor, right? They would throw their coins in. Bring, bring, bring. Look at how generous I am. And what does Jesus say to them in Matthew 23? Woe to you. Jesus is not impressed with what they do. He says, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees. You're hypocrites. For you tithe mint and dill and cumin, and you've neglected the weightier matters of the law. And here it is, justice, mercy, and faithfulness. So verse 8, in a way, it hurts because it challenges our motives. And it forces us to ask the question, well, why do we do what we do for God? Do we follow God maybe half-heartedly just to win some type of favor from him or to simply get to heaven? Do we perform religious activities with pride and sin in our hearts? Would we rather God just let us live how we want without any commands or restraints? See, many so-called Christians live like this. I will come to church, I'll tithe, I'll jump through the hoops, and I'll do these certain outward things because then God will be impressed with that. And we say similar things. God, what do you want from me? More church attendance? More tithing? More sacrifice? Like, what do you want, God? And God says, I don't want you to just do the right thing and check the right box and go through the right motions. God says, I want your heart. I want you to obey me, yes, but even more than that, God wants us to want to obey him, right? It's actually about our motivations, because the Pharisees obeyed. Check, 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 check. And what does God say? Woe to you. So God's not just interested in perfect obedience. God's interested in our motivation behind our obedience. Now, here's what's amazing. Jesus perfectly lived this out. Jesus did justice. He cared for the oppressed and the poor. Jesus touched lepers. He ate with sinners. He cared for those who were the outcasts of society. Jesus' heart was full of justice for the weak. That's why he flipped the tables in the temple. Jesus also loved kindness. He was merciful to people. He showed love and kindness to people. And Jesus walked humbly. He was lowly. He was not prideful. He walked humbly with his Father. But here's the thing. If Jesus is only an example for us to follow, then that's terribly crushing, because we'll all leave here going, well, I'm not as good as Jesus. But I've heard pastors and preachers, they sometimes say, you know, Jesus was just a man, right? He emptied himself and he lived as a man and he empowered by the Holy Spirit. So you have the Holy Spirit, so you should do everything that Jesus did. And what that's doing is actually putting a weight that crushes you, because we aren't Jesus. That's the whole point of the gospel. You and I are unable to do this. God says, do justice, love mercy, walk humbly with me. And the whole point is, I can't do it. Because of my sinfulness, I need Jesus, not just as an example, but as a savior. And when I realize that and I confess my sin and I repent and I give my life to Jesus, his death and his resurrection redeems me, and his perfect life and obedience is credited to me. And now, by the power of the Holy Spirit, God changes my motivations. So even though none of us are going to perfectly live this out, our heart cry is we desire to live this out. We want to do justice. We want to love kindness. We want to walk humbly with God. We long for it. And so the Holy Spirit does a work in us to change our hearts so we begin to live like that. And there's so many examples in the New Testament, and we won't go to those examples, but there's passage after passage then that calls us by the power of the Holy Spirit to live like this, to be humble, to care for widows and orphans, to do justice, to love mercy, all of these things. See, the call is to do these things not simply to jump through the hoops or do the bare minimum, but in response to what God has done for us. Out of our great love for Jesus, we remember what happened on the cross, we remember what Jesus has done, and then we pursue these things. So I want to challenge us this morning. What is your motivation for following God? And here's the thing, I think oftentimes our motivations come to the surface when we're confronted with pain, suffering, disappointment. When hardship comes, we often ask God, what do you want, God? God, I thought I was doing all of these things for you. Do you want more? Like, what could you possibly want, God? And so suffering and pain and disappointment, it very quickly reveals the motivation of our hearts. And so ask yourselves, why do you follow Jesus? Do you follow him because you think then you'll get favor from God and an easy life? And maybe, you know, well, I don't want to go to hell, so I'll follow Jesus if I can avoid that. Or does your life, you know, from one degree to the next, does your life resemble and mirror Jesus? Do you do justice? Do you care about oppressed people? Do you love kindness and mercy and loyalty? Do you love steadfastness? And do you walk humbly, just day by day with Jesus? So, Father, I just thank you for this challenge from your word. God, I thank you that you are a God who does not change. You are the same today, yesterday, and forever. God, in the Old Testament, you were not a God of indifference, that you just, I don't care about people, I just want them to blindly obey me. No, you actually cared about people's hearts. And Jesus, you care about our hearts. And you care about our motivations for following and obeying you. You're not interested in perfect obedience while our hearts are far from you. And that was the Pharisees. And Jesus, you pronounced woe on them. Because yes, they jumped through all the hoops, but they actually didn't love you, God. And so God, I pray that you would just challenge our motivations. That you would produce in us not just obedience, but a desire to be obedient. Out of a deep love for you, not out of, you know, a free ticket out of hell, but because of what you've done for us. And so God, help us as we go through seasons of pain and disappointment and suffering, that our response would not be, well, what do you want from me, God? But our response would be, let's remind ourselves of how faithful you are, God. Let's look back to the cross and we know what the answer isn't. The answer isn't that you don't love us. You've proven that you love us. And that we would just cling to those past events in our lives as we work through pain and suffering and disappointment. So God, just do that work in our lives. Just change our hearts so that we just long to obey you, even when we mess up. Help us, God, to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with you. And so we just pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen. So that is the end of our service this morning. We're going to put discussion questions on the screen. If you're interested in, you know, turning to the people around you and just having a discussion about some of the stuff in the message, we do that for you. I'm available for prayer. If you would like prayer, I would love to pray with you. Christy is also available to pray if you want to pray with someone. But if not, thank you for joining us. Thanks for joining us online. If you have prayer requests, you can always text us, 778-400-4549, and we would love to pray for you. God bless you. Thanks for joining us.